It was a scheme which demanded a very huge governmental budget for support. And we saw an exodus of doctors who resigned from their position from government-run hospital. And they moved to private sector because of the overwhelming of the work. And we saw also double standards of medical medication and treatment everywhere. Another possibility is that when the scheme is fully implemented, it will catalyze family breakdown due to more individualism in community, and people will feel less dependent on one another. Now, this is another survey run by ABAC at Suntaree University, and was published in Manchon newspaper, which is a national newspaper, which is very political, published on February the 5th of this year. A survey report was conducted by the Office of Health System Research Institute and Assumption University poll on the 13,497 people from September the 1st of last year to October the 31st. And 34% of the people felt that the healthcare services provided by the government are inadequate. 72.9% urged government to solve problems of overcrowded tertiary care hospital urgently. 59.3% felt that the government provided insufficient budget for public health. 87.1% suggested government to establish more healthcare centers. These are problems that we're facing now. So I am looking for answer to healthcare reform from Buddhist point of view. Apart from that, we have additional problems. The new challenge of healthcare reform is Thailand is an aging country. We have aging population. Because success of family planning and campaigns run by the Ministry of Public Health during the 70s throughout the end of the millennium has apparently decreased population growth rate from 1.3 in 1994 to 1.1 in 1996, and right now it's about 1.0 in the year 2000, and it's remained at this rate, very stable. Apart from that, we see aging population, a ratio to total population is increasing from 0.3 in 1947, it rose to 0.8 in 1990, and then 12.2 in 1998, and it's projected to the future, it will increase to 19.6 in 2025. The population ratio, the aging population, will increase almost to 20% of the total population. We need to have a better healthcare system. Now, I'm taking this from Buddhist Bioethics, the canonical literature of Buddhism, the story of a Buddha healing of a sick monk. There was a monk who was suffering from diarrhea, and the Lord Buddha was approaching and asked him what illness are you suffering from, and the monk replied, "Diarrhea, sir. Don't you have anyone to take care of you?" He said, "No, sir." "What is the reason? Why is the reason that other monks are not taking care of you?" And he answered, "My Lord, I have not been good to any other monks. Because of this, they do not take care of me." And the Lord Buddha told his assistant Ananda to drink water, and both the Buddha and Ananda helped to bathe the monk. Then he, after taking care of the monk, he called for community meeting, and then he told that anyone who wants to take care of me should take care of the ill. If nobody in the community did, the whole community how to take care. So it's a responsibility of the whole community. Care for the ill is the serving of the Buddha. There could be reason behind this. One can say that one is serving Buddha because he is a caring person. Or because Buddha nature is in everyone. And we see that the community, in Buddhist community, there are three functions: spiritual, educational, and health. Sangha is a family of care and nurturing, and failing to care for anyone is a misconduct of Buddhist community, the whole Sangha. So I conclude that there are three pillars of the quality of life, which are spirituality, education, and healthcare. So this is something that we could apply in our community. Especially in Thailand, we have 6 million people registered as volunteers with the Ministry of Culture. Volunteer is at the grassroots can be promoted. And by this, we saw new movement. Things are moving in, and we saw that Buddhist monks already serving as primary health care. So by training monks and initiate healthcare services based on these three qualities, and decentralization of government administration, established healthcare reform, development of local leadership and infrastructure, we have village banking system emerge, so we could have solved problems in community. However, there is a problem in Buddhist community so far because it is managed by a feudalistic system. Monastic education should be improved and popular, and also Buddhists should learn more about Buddhist practice, Buddhist ethic in applying to science. By suggesting the decentralization of monastic administration, modernization of study, promotion of socially engaged Buddhism, set up a network and social activism in urban and rural areas. Culture has been forgotten resource of healthcare reform in Thailand, and volunteer works could create culture of care. Government support by producing knowledge, training, setting standard activities and programs at its grassroots level can improve, and it can help community to solve problems in the future of aging population. And it also we can link to university, volunteers or a student could be selected for study in medical school or nursing school, and they can return. In this way we can have a sustainable development. And that was my message in my paper.
Thank you very much. We have time for a short one or two questions.
Thank you. That was a very interesting talk. My name is Gerald McKinney. I'm from the University of Notre Dame. I might characterize this as a middle way between libertarian, to use a Buddhist term, between libertarianism and egalitarianism. But it presupposes that Buddhism and its principles, its commitments and convictions are still a very strong social and cultural force in Thailand. And it also assumes that a model that was designed to work in the Sangha, which in some ways was deeply interrelated but still distinct from the community at large, can apply. I know you do it in a nuanced way, but nevertheless it presupposes that model can apply to the community at large. So those two points to my question. Is Buddhism, is it as vibrant as a social force and cultural force in Thailand as it has been in the past, and can the Sangha really function as a model for the whole society when it was designed and has always functioned as a very distinct community, even albeit related closely to the community?
My answer is yes. Buddhism is still vibrant, lively, and strong. But sadly, our government policy in the past have ignored its role in promoting health. And I think it's time to bring about this strength of society. And by working together in community, using a volunteer recruitment, I think we can solve other problems in the future. There already exists a number of centers in Thailand, no less than 10, which rose from Buddhist movement at the grassroots. And they admit membership, and each member pay 1 baht a day. 1 baht a day. And by 1 baht a day, this cover everything. They go to hospital, getting care, and then now in some center, the circulating amount of money is over 30 million. Incredibly big. It's better than the 30 baht universal coverage of the government. And I think it would be a good project to push forward. So we would have healthcare would belong to the community, it would belong to people, and it will be managed by the people. And it's for the people.
Thank you. Lady first, and then Susanna.
Could you elaborate on the quality of the older people in Thailand and the healthcare system available for the senior citizens?
Yes, we have, well, the government have just initiated project for senior citizens, or they call older people. Older people. And they try, they have a society for older people in different parts of Thailand, in more than half of the country. They have this kind of a club or society. But it is not very strong yet. My wish is to see these club and these society join force with education and also monastic or religious center to promote lifelong program, you see, because the three function, religion, education, and healthcare, we all need three of them throughout our life, and is the foundation of the quality of life of individuals. However, when we set up a government, the bureaucracy separate all these three functions. So the service is bureaucratized, it hardly serves at the grassroots. So if we set up center like this, with owned by the people, flexible enough to care, to create lifelong education and many programs to promote health, exercise, recreation, painting, music, dancing, with religious activities, we can create a very good environment for people, and the value and the meaning of life will increase among citizens. So I think it is a worthy effort for the government to approach health this way. And the strength is 6 million volunteers in Thailand. Out of 60 million, 10% of the people identify themselves as volunteer. The government haven't tapped into this cultural resource. We can use this cultural resource to promote health. It will save a lot of money, it will save time, it will include better quality of life for the people.
You mentioned the hierarchical nature of the present monkhood. In the early period of Buddhism, mainland women were equal, and also you had monks and nuns who were equal. Now, in Thailand today, there's strong resistance to introduce the nuns' order, which would facilitate the nuns going down and interacting in hospitals and people. So, what's your take on that? How should that be changed?
I think it should be changed as soon as possible. I think you're addressing the right person in Thailand, and the only monk who stood up for women's rights, Dr. Sorat and Dr. Somparn know about that. I wrote books in support of them, but which infuriated many senior monks in Thailand. And they think quality of life of the people will increase if we don't have sexual discrimination. I believe that the original teaching of the Buddha, he did not favor men over women. Sadly, bad thing happened to Buddhism after the Buddha died. So I'm not going into this, but I believe that equality of genders is essential to have a moral society. And I believe that women contribute a lot for the growth and security of religion. In Thailand, we have more than 30,000 temples. Only 25 of them accept women to stay there as resident. Whereas women contribute more than 80% to this community. They benefit them less than 1%. So I think for Thai people and Thai culture, women empowerment is very important and essential for the growth and security of life of the people.
Thank you very much. Very beautiful. And the next question is from the second.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning, the organizer. Good morning, the chair. And good morning, all participants. This is my turn to talk to you. How to improve consumer protection with Buddhist ethics, necessity, possibility, and challenge. I need to introduce myself a little bit. I'm a lecturer in the Chulalongkorn University at the Faculty of Pharmaceutical Science. I'm a pharmacist. I'm a lecturer in this faculty to teach my students on consumer protection in healthcare. What I try to do today is try to explain the key concept of protection in the Buddhist approach and try to apply the Buddhist concept to be another model for healthcare in consumer protection area. And I try to compare the Buddhist model with an existing consumer protection model, or we can call it Western model. Like other developing countries, Thailand has adopted the Western model of consumer protection in order to protect Thai consumers, including in the area of consumer health. And when I say consumer protection, you may think of these things: consumer rights, legal enforcement, consumer education, healthcare experts, consumer. And if we try to construct a simple model, we will think about consumer, producer, maybe the drug company and the regulator, maybe the FDA is one of the Thai drug regulator. But even we have all of these components, we still have problems. The Thai consumer have faced substandard, unsafe, expensive pharmaceuticals and healthcare products. And also, we find that the problem is not only in our country. It's more interesting that when unsafe drug was often found even in the USA and Europe and in many, many developing countries. So if we turn to the basic consumer protection model, we will see we have producer, like the drug company, consumer, and regulator. Consumer and producer, they are all interest group in Western model. And the regulator has responsible to apply the law and regulation to control the producer. And they have, the regulator, they have to promote consumer right to the consumer. But what we found is there are so many drug companies try to manipulate consumer by advertising. And it is so strange that if you find one of billboard or the expressway in Bangkok, they try to say something like the drug company could help the FDA to protect the consumer. But they say counterfeit medicine is so harmful today. Call the FDA, the Thai FDA, at 1556 with our concern from Thai FDA and sponsored by the Pfizer, the famous US drug company who sell Viagra. And so we will use some concept of consumer politics concept that apply to our Thailand. We have two organizations, Food and Administration of called FDA, and we have Department of Medical Science who set the laboratory, the good laboratory. And we have law and regulation, we have drug and food law, we have consumer protection law, and we have the consumer right and patient right, the best way that people think that this is the best way to protect the consumer. And we try to apply the principle of biomedical ethics, autonomy, beneficent, or do no harm, justice. Even though we try to apply good governance, evidence-based medicine, conflict of interest in our healthcare system. But I'm sure that this all of governance are effective. I would like to analyze some of examples of the four consumer rights. As you may know, there are four consumer rights: right to information, right to choice, right to safety, and right to be heard and read. The first TCAN group to say that please buy product wisely, and if you find any problems, do not worry. Just buy service from lawyer wisely. What they are going to tell you? They tell you that buy and buy and buy. So it means that they are going to promote consumerism. What consumer protection model propose? They propose that we are all competitors in a capitalist world. So we can stay with the negotiation, to maintain our life. So everyone is self-interest and will protect their interest to maximize their interest. This is the idea that foundation concept of the Western consumer protection model. What consumer protection model propose? For a good producer, they say that a good producer is one who complies with law and regulation, and they will ensure their product with the best scientific standard. And for the active consumer, they should protect their rights and they should get more information as much as possible. And for the regulator, they have to be responsible for their duty, and they have to have a legal knowledge, scientific knowledge to protect the consumer. But saying a consumer protection model implies that the consumer would be happy if they could consume more and more. Their happiness is based on consumerism. So I will try to do some Buddhist concept. Buddhist concept say about the true nature of life.